Hi, Nuan the Movie Slinger here with a discussion on Ready Player One. Ever since the movie came out this year, the fans have been saying it's not as good as the book. Of course, that's what the book fans always say. Well, I watched the movie and read the book and I gotta disagree. The movie is way better than the book. Here's five reasons why. Reason number one, the riddles. The riddles in the book are mostly obscure references to some old video game or music album. Now, I'm cool with that, but it would have been so much cooler if the riddles had thematic relevance not only to the video game, movie, or music it's drawing inspiration from, but also to Halliday's life. There's often no connection like that. It's just a reference. You don't learn anything about Halliday by solving it. In the movie, the riddles don't feel random. A creator who hates his own creation is a reference not only to Stephen King's The Shining, but also to Halliday himself, who had his own personal demons to deal with after creating The Oasis. His life story is a tragedy, and how appropriate that the final key is located inside Fortress Tragic, which is revealed to be Halliday's own castle, where he shut himself away from his friends and the rest of society. So in the book, you can solve the riddles by knowing the references to stuff Halliday liked. But in the movie, you have to understand what he felt in order to solve them. I like the movie version more. It gives a stronger emotional connection to Halliday. It's also a hero's journey as our naive protagonist Wade, who starts out as a blind fanboy of 80s pop culture, grows into a stronger character as he learns from Halliday's mistakes. And if he didn't learn, he wouldn't be able to resist the final test of signing the contract. Also in the book, the Rush album cover is a clue. Really? You can just Google that. Reason number two, the video game challenges. A lot of challenges in the book involve playing an old Atari video game or an arcade machine inside the Oasis. So it's basically the avatar sitting in front of a TV playing a game. Do you realize how boring that is? Not for the character maybe, but for the reader? The avatar is inside the video game world already. Why not use the weapons, abilities, and mech suits in an action-packed sequence? Don't just sit there and play a video game. In the movie, this only happens for the final challenge, and it's done really beautifully. It's not only a tribute to the original Easter egg in Adventure, it's also thematically relevant. It's the story of a creator who lost control over his own video game. Warren Robinet, the game's designer, wasn't even officially credited by Atari, so he had to hide his name inside the game as an Easter egg. In Ready Player One, Halliday's creation is in danger of falling into the hands of IOI, so you can see the connection there. And for the rest of the challenges, we get plenty of action. The car chase is one of the best action sequences I've seen this year. It's a thrilling roller coaster ride that also gives the filmmakers plenty of opportunities to throw in pop culture references. And these references from King Kong to Back to the Future all work together to enhance the experience. It feels like a video game brought to life, which is the whole point of the Oasis. Also, Halliday wants to go back in time and change his past, so the solution to the challenge is also going back. And Percival drives a time-traveling car to do that. There's also the Shining challenge where they have to run and avoid the old zombie crone and Jack Nicholson's character while they figure out the clue. It's very fast-paced, it's funny and exciting. The challenges in the book are never this entertaining or engaging. For example, there's the Captain Crunch whistle challenge where Percival has to collect the trophies hidden inside the house. He uses a freaking walkthrough to figure out what to do. There's no surprises at all. He's just going through a house collecting stuff. In a single sentence, it mentions that he battled a troll and a cyclops. Why didn't Cline describe that battle in detail? That would have been exciting, right? Reason number three, the reenactment of movies. In the book, some of the challenges involve Percival having to reenact a movie sequence like Monty Python. This is cool for like 5 minutes, and then you realize all Percival has to do is recite dialogue. It's not about solving a puzzle or figuring out a riddle. If you watched the movie 100 times and memorized all the lines, you could pass this test. Now, I do this too. I've memorized most of Lord of the Rings, so I can actually relate to this, but this is not very exciting to read about. The movie takes the characters inside Stanley Kubrick's adaptation of The Shining, which was written by Stephen King. The difference is that Percival and his team have to solve a mystery to win. Standing around reciting lines would have gotten them hacked to death by the old crone in the bathtub. Also, I mentioned before the thematic relevance. Stephen King famously hated Stanley Kubrick's adaptation. It's also the movie that Halliday decided to watch instead of taking his girl out for dancing. It's also implied that he regretted creating The Oasis because it kept him distracted from the things that mattered most. Reason number four, repetition. There's a lot of repetition in the book. The reenactment of movies happens a few times in the book. It's like the author ran out of ideas and just used the same gimmick for a different movie each time. The segments where Percival plays an old video game is also repeated. This is dull and is just pure filler content, and probably done because there's the chance to appeal to more people by having a different movie or game each time the gimmick is reused. In the movie, each riddle, challenge, or action sequence is different. It's a video game simulation world. There's hundreds of things to do. Why would you have to repeat anything? Reason number five, the character of Og, or Ogden Morrow, Halliday's best friend. In the movie, he's hiding inside the Oasis as the curator of Halliday's museum. This is thematically brilliant. He's the guardian of Halliday's memories, protecting his best friend's legacy and waiting for someone truly worthy to finish the quest and save the Oasis. How does he identify the worthy? By seeing who can truly understand what Halliday went through. Not just his passion for 80s pop culture, but also understand how that passion, which one might call obsession, left him alone and without any friends at the time of his passing. In the movie, Percival figures out that Halliday was still in love with Karen, who eventually went on to marry his best friend Og, and then she passed away. He regretted not telling her, and also he had to hide his feelings for her from his best friend. This was the reason why he distanced himself from Og and Karen. In the movie, Og didn't know this until Percival tells him. In that scene, if you look closely at the background, you can actually see the curator double-checking the records and realizing Percival is right. This is why he decides to give Percival the extra life coin, which becomes useful later on. In the book, he's a creepy old dude who loves to spy on teenage kids. That's right, in the book he can become invisible. Once Percival and his friends gets in his radar, he's there in their virtual chat room, listening and watching everything they do. I'm so glad the movie didn't ruin Simon Pegg's character by making him spy on kids. Also in the movie, the final test is the contract signing. It's a reminder of how Halliday cut off all ties with his best friend, which is revealed to be his biggest regret. Okay, so let's conclude this by bringing together everything we talked about. In the movie, almost all the riddles and challenges and memories of Halliday show how his creation consumed his life as he hid himself inside it and ignored his best friend and the woman that he loved. It shows his regrets as its creator. The movie also shows what video game addiction does to people's lives, like wasting real money on digital purchases, and the mother that ignores taking care of her kid. It also shows that Korean guy who almost committed suicide. That's a real issue in South Korea. So the movie is giving this really important message that yes, video games, movies, music, and all this stuff is super cool, and it's great if you love it. But it doesn't excuse you from your responsibilities in the real world. At some point, you gotta wake up and spend time with the people you care about. Now that's a well-balanced message. I never got that message from any of the riddles or challenges in the book. Halliday's feelings of regret didn't come across at all. In the movie, understanding his regrets was key to winning the quest. It's why Og deems Percival to be worthy of the extra life. Ernst Cline, the author of the book, also wrote the first draft of the movie script, which was then rewritten by Eric Eason and Zach Penn. I'm so glad that they took creative liberties when adapting the book, instead of being 100% faithful to the source material. Being 100% faithful to this book would be, metaphorically speaking, masturbating to nostalgia and pop culture like a bunch of brain-dead zombies, while remaining ignorant of the real-world issues and negative aspects of said pop culture phenomena. In the movie, every plot-related pop culture reference meant something important to the characters and the story. This is also why you needed somebody like Steven Spielberg to direct this movie. Spielberg knows that all the spectacle and special effects in the world would mean nothing if there's no heart to it. So he used the 80s nostalgia and love of movies, video games, and music to draw people in, but then delivered a very heartfelt, emotional, and relevant message. It's relevant and also timely because although there's no Oasis yet, people are pretty much hooked and addicted to social media. And Spielberg is saying, you should unplug once in a while. Take a walk outside, it's nice there. And if it's not nice outside, maybe do something about it. The movie also got rid of the boring elements, especially the segments of repetition. It took us inside a video game, instead of just showing a character in a video game play another video game. I like the book, I think it's alright, but I think the movie surpassed it in every way. It's got the pure, joyful Spielberg magic that I wish every movie had. So, watch Ready Player One if you haven't already. Read the book too. If you have, what do you think? Leave your thoughts in the comments below, and thanks for watching. Don't forget to like and subscribe. Movie Slinger out.